But Father, we just want to honor
yes.
you this morning, Lord.
Thank you.
And we thank you for giving us this day, Lord.
Yes.
You know, I pray, Lord, that you're the center of our lives, Lord.
Yes.
Something else would be taking your place, Lord.
Yes.
You know, no cares, no concerns, no well eyes of the enemy, Lord, no weapon of the enemy
yes.
to prosper against us, God.
Thank you, Father.
I thank you, Lord, that in faith, Lord, we'll overcome this world.
Yes, Jesus.
So I thank you, Father, for increasing our faith.
Thank you.
God, every day, Lord, give us the ability to stand.
Yes.
Fight the good fight, Lord.
Amen.
I thank you, Father, that it's by your grace we're here today.
Yes, Jesus.
Thank you for giving us this morning, Lord. And thank you for just this time to gather
in your
yes. Lord. Whatever it is you want to say, let it be said.
Thank you.
In Jesus.
Yes.
Amen.
Lord Jesus.
Amen.
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 It's cool to think about because, I mean, really, you know, when you worship by yourself, it's you and God. And it's kind of it's very similar when you're in a collective setting like this. You know, it's really between you and the Lord.
Yeah.
You know, it's really cool to think about. And, you know, while I was on the trip to Cleveland this week, I thought a lot about my thinking. And when you're out on your own, you find out where exactly you fall with God and where you fall with the enemy. You know, you don't know what you got through testing.
Yeah.
And a lot of times our thinking can give us a victory or our thinking can cause us defeat. Because life is lived in the mind.
Yeah.
And a lot of times, you know, the enemy wants to infiltrate our brains. He wants to get in the ways of what's causing us to act, you know. And that was one thing I realized, even though I got together with these guys Thursday night, or Wednesday night, and had a great time with them. It was amazing because you can get around people who are unsaved and be able to communicate with them effectively things of life and ministry and what God's doing in your life. But it's so weird, the separation sometimes, you know, the way they think and the way you think. And it really causes you to really start thinking about thinking. That sounds weird, but it does. It makes you think about just how this world operates compared to how a person who hears God operates. And, you know, there's always a good time to sow seed. There's never a bad time to sow seed. There's always an opportunity to sow.
Yeah.
And I started thinking about what the Bible says, that if you sow into the flesh, you reap death. But if you sow into the spirit, you reap life and peace.
Yes.
And I started thinking, like, ungodly thinking brings about ungodly practices and brings about ungodly actions. And how much it is important that we think about really where we are from every day.
Amen.
It's not just about, you know, can I sin or can I not sin? Can I do this right or can I not do it right? Am I going to say the right thing or am I not going to say the right thing? It's really about connecting with God where He's at, and that is in eternity. And to fix our minds in that place of eternal thinking.
Amen.
Because, you know, if you think about it, we've been really prone to think about going home and thinking about waiting for Jesus and our expectation that Jesus is going to come back and rapture His church. And that is where our minds are fixed, and that is not a bad place. Because essentially what we're trying to do is disconnect from this reality. We're in it, but we're not of it. We've heard a lot of people say, too heavenly minded, the earth is good. But if you really think about the reality of that statement, how many men were so heavenly minded that they made the greatest impacts in this world? Because they were so heavenly minded that they were willing to lay down their lives.
Yeah.
I hear, you know, apologetics like Robbie Zacharias or other men of God, I'm sure Billy Graham invested a lot of his life away from his family and invested a lot of his time and his energy and his tears and his prayers to people that weren't of his family. And he continued to give in that manner because he was so fixed on eternity. These men were fixed on eternal realities. They weren't willing to come off them. I'm sure there was fights and days, just like every one of us faced. But the reality is there is an eternal reality that every one of our minds have to engage.
Yeah.
We have to stay seated in the place where Jesus is. Because he says we're called to be heirs with him.
Amen.
You know, we're seated in heavenly places. And our home is not here. It's actually in eternity. So as we're operating on a day-to-day basis, that is our fight a lot of times. Are we engaging and being pulled into this temporal reality? Or are we warring in a sense of, we're from eternity warring against this temporal reality?
Yeah.
It's almost like you fix your mind on it, you know? It's like you want to engage in a good battle, a good fight. Sorry, thank you. Oh, yeah. That's really bad. I was like, where'd the rest of my strength go? Look like 80s rock or otherwise. Thanks. I wish. Not never. But you know, that's one thing I thought about. I was really just letting the Lord speak to me about being engaged eternally because, you know, I could have looked at that whole week gone and been like, you know, away from my friends, away from my church, my family. But I can also look at it like, God, yeah, wherever I am, you are.
Amen.
You know, wherever He is, He goes with us. And we need to look at life like that when we go out the doors, you know, where are we engaging? You know, are we engaging in an eternal perspective? You know, because at that place, I don't think you're worried about what people think about you. You're not worried about how this is going to come off. You're not worried about, you know, so we're sitting there and I got guys around me. Every one of them have a beard but me. I have a Mountain Dew. And, you know, it wasn't a self-righteous feeling, but it was like, no, this is who I am. And I'm not ashamed of that. You know, I'm a man of God, and I represent God wherever I go. And it's something to always think about is, where are we connected? Where is our home? You know, wherever your home is, there your heart is. You see the signs sometimes you walk in people's houses, you know, where your home is, there your heart is.
Yeah.
Stuff like that. And I thought about that because I want to be connected with God in such a place when I go into eternity, it's like I'm just stepping into it. You know, I'm engaging with my Savior in such a way that I'm like, God, it's good to see you. Because all I've been doing is, we've been talking for all this time, and it's so good to finally get to hold you and see you. And in Isaiah 26, verse 3, it says, thou will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee.
Yes.
And I'm sure to think about that. You know, when your mind starts to wander, it starts to war, it starts to wage, and you feel that wavering where you're like, God, you know, I'm really going through it, I'm struggling, or I'm wrestling with this reality, or I'm dealing with this problem. And I realize that the mind that has the peace, the perfect peace that surpasses our understanding, like the New Testament says, is really because that mind is turning away from this temporal thinking and the limitations of it. Because you're limited in this reality. We just aren't. We're limited in our ability. We're limited in God and His ability, because God is able in all things.
Amen.
All things are possible to those who believe.
Yes.
You know, like making a bill or getting a rent lowered because, you know, God's just doing different things, different seasons. And I believe anytime I've ever heard of people going through a great trial, a great reaping comes after that because you don't give up. And I do believe that. David, I mean, how many trials did he go through early on? And then he eventually came into his kingdomship, you know, his rulership.
Yeah.
And he got to oversee people and operate in that place. But he had to go through the fire.
Yeah, he did.
And proving ground to show who he really was. And I think those who really trust in God and walk with God in that level will endure in that place. You have to go through the furnace to be purified. Amen. And to see who you really are. And that was really what this week was about for me. It was a testing of my mind and realizing that God, His love doesn't change. His realities don't change. Even though circumstantial life changes, it always changes. Like today, this morning, it isn't your typical Sunday service. And I'm okay with that because God's still God. He doesn't change.
Man.
And I'm okay with that. You know, and that's life in general. Every day when we engage life, it's, can we be okay with life and realize that God is still God? And we are eternally connected in such a way that reality doesn't change. And you have to engage life in that sense. And I don't mean to be teaching in a sense, but it's like we do have to fight to keep our minds eternally connected. Because I'm going to be ruling and reign with Jesus.
Yes.
And I have to look at life that way. When I'm engaging this world, I'm going to be ruling and reign with Jesus. I'm the Son of God. Engaging in that way when I come to this world. So when I meet people who are lost, and trust me, I talk to a lot of people, you know, anywhere from marriage to sin to any, you know, you name it, we had a lot of conversations. And the one thing I realized that never changed was my perspective. It was always driven from biblical perspective.
Amen.
Every time, you know, we're talking with someone, whether it's just encouraging or, you know, advising even, you know, you find yourself sometimes, I remember working at Tire Man, and my manager pulled me into the office, man, I'm having this issue with my marriage, what do you think? And I just met the guy. You know, but there's something about our lives that speak to people, and you're speaking on behalf of God. And when you introduce godly principle, you're really introducing God's kingdom. And He said, let them know the kingdom is drawn by.
Amen.
So you're planting these seeds of kingdom into people's life. And eventually they're going to realize, God is the way I want to do this. This is working out for these guys. Even though they're going through the fire, they're having troubles, they're waging war every day. Yet there's some kind of thing that's going on in life that's called peace. Why? Because we trust in God fully.
Amen.
We're eternally connected. We're not willing to come off of that, right? You're not willing to come off of that. I was telling Sean that, talking to him, and I'm like,
that's good. Good word.
You know, I told him, I said, you know how you know you're not slipping? It's because you're still thinking about him. You feel distant, but yet you're longing to be so close to him like you have been in the past. I said, that's, you know, a marital relationship. Because even when me and my wife, we teeter-totter, we go back and forth, we have our fights, we have our issues, the reality is I always long to be by her side at the end of the day. And I think about it. I think about God the same way. It's like, even though I may be distant from God, my heart is to be so close to Him. I want to be close. You know, and I said, that's how you know your heart's connected with God, is when all you can do is think about that.
Yeah.
You think about God always. He's always on your mind. You know, a lot of love songs talk about, you're always on my mind, you know, and that's reality. When you're in love with God, He is always on your mind.
Yeah.
You, no matter where you're situationally at, you're connected in such a way, it's eternally connected. You know, it's so cool when you think about it, because that reality never changes. So even though we're suffering and going through this reality of change always, we're still eternally connected in a way that never changes.
That's right.
And that is, we are sons.
That's good.
And it doesn't change. The enemy can never take that from us. So no matter if you sin, doesn't matter if you fall, doesn't matter if you drop the ball or you didn't say this or that, it doesn't change. And the cool thing is, because God won't allow it to change, because it'll change who God is. God said he is love.
Yeah.
Love endures long. It endures. It does everything that 1 Corinthians chapter 13 says. It does not change.
Yeah.
So his love for us will never change. The only thing that changes is our hearts towards him. So when we remind ourselves of that, it's like, oh, I can endure anything. I can go through anything, you know. Nothing will ever change my mind towards God because we're eternally connected in such a way.
Amen.
So Romans chapter 12, verse 2, it says, and be not conformed to this world.
Amen.
You know, that's the war that we're fighting always, is not to fit the conformity of this world. We're not here to engage God in such a way that when we come in and there's 5 people, 10 people, or 30 people, our worship for God changes. It should never change.
Right, amen.
When if you're worshiping God on an individual basis through your week, it should not change when you walk in this building. The reality is, it's you and God again, and you're here for one reason, to get with God.
Thank you.
Nothing else should change that. Because I guarantee when you're home, you got kids crying, or you got work, you got people calling, you got stuff to fix, but you're still actively engaging in worship, right? It's a lifestyle. It isn't just a momentary playing music.
Amen.
It's a heart connection.
Yeah.
Worship is all the time.
Thank you.
So, we're not being conformed to this world, but it says, but be ye transformed. How? By the renewing of your mind. Why? Because you're eternally connected.
Amen.
The renewing of your mind is establishing who you are in Christ. It's eternal. It doesn't change. And that's the cool thing. When Adam and Eve were in the garden, they had fellowship with God all the time. They had a status. When they sinned, they lost their image. Amen. See, Jesus came to reestablish our image, right? He's bringing us back to that eternal reality of who we really are. And that's why, at the end, we will judge angels. Cool. Think about it. You look at yourself in such a low state. I look at myself in such a low state many a times. I'm like, but that reality hits. It's, I am a son. That carries weight.
Yeah,
not that I'm anything. It's the blood of Christ that makes me a son.
That's right.
We're heirs because of the blood, the inheritance that we're given, but the reality is that eternal connection makes it so much more than what we look at. When you go home and you look at the mirror and you look at all your failures and your shortcomings and your struggles and your worries, your anxieties, that reality that's still there, the whispering voice saying, you're my son, that'll never change. That'll always stay the same. Doesn't matter if you sin, you fall, you're struggling with this identity of who you are, let God establish that. That's why insecurity is such a powerful thing, because it's you trying to make an image for who you think you need to be. But the reality is God already said who you are. You're a son. You're his child. You don't have to be any more than what God makes you. And that's enough for him. And he'll do everything he needs you to do every day when you're engaging God in that way. God, you're my father. So I said, Lord's Prayer, right? Our Father, right there. First thing, you establish God is your Father. That does not change. He will always and forever be your Father. Eternally and for now. Even those who deny God in such a way because of their ignorance and then their, you know, just this reality. Because I was reading, you read Romans chapter 8, and it's talking about we were predestined, right? For the predestination, because those who he'd chosen, you know, he's justified. Those he justified are glorified. And it's a process. And I realized God is always moving our lives through a process. He's always bringing us to one degree of glory to the next. And that glory is simply a deeper relationship with him. Because it's him emanating on you, church. It's his glory. It's not because we're going to be awesome. It's God's glory imparted into our lives. And I realize that it's just this renewing our mind of who we really are. That's what this life is all about. It's becoming who we once were in eternity. Because God knows the from the beginning to the end. And before the world was created, we were there. So that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. It's touch not, taste not. It's not limited. So when you're here on this earth, you're here to simply operate as a son. That's it. You don't have to be anything more than that. You don't have to try and build a church. God will build his church. Yeah. You don't have to try to be a born or child of God. You already are a child of God. Yeah. It's just allowing our minds to come to that grips. I don't have to do anything to be good enough. Jesus loves enough. And that makes me a son. And I'll stay in that place. And the devil cannot take that place from me. That is your right. And we need to own that. We need to walk in that every day. Because that's where your mind starts to be renewed. You won't go in this wavy process of who am I? Who am I, God? Why am I not doing this? Why am I doing that? It's no. When God's leading you, he's leading you. And wherever you go, he's with you. And that's the reality we got to walk in. And that establishes exactly who he is. It's acceptable. It's perfect. It's an awesome thing to have that kind of standing with God. It doesn't change. So Romans chapter 8, verse 5 through 8 says, for they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh. You're worried about your family, you're worried about the bills, you're worried about the things that really try to get a hold of your heart. We're to let those down at the feet of Jesus.
Amen.
And it says, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. Excuse me. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is subject to the law
to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. So when we disengage this world, we disengage reality, God, we disengage the warfare that's constantly going against our heart, the anxieties, the fears, this insecurities, whatever's going on in everyone's individual life, we all have something that we're fighting against. And so you shed this mortality, you have a warfare going on. Because it's an enemy with God. This flesh doesn't like God, and God don't like the flesh. It'll never be that way. That's why it has to go back to the earth. It has to die. In Colossians 3, verse 1 through 4, it says it great. It says, if ye then be risen with Christ, if you want to be risen with Christ, if you're willing to proclaim you're risen with Christ today, seek those things which are above.
Amen.
Set your mind. Where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on the things of this earth.
Yes, Jesus.
See, affection is, when you break it down to the Greek and Hebrew, it's essentially talking about the deeper seated part of your emotion. It's talking about the part that motivates us the most. Think about lust. Think about love. Anger. They're very powerful motivators, aren't they? When you get angry, boom, you're in the moment. Or you're in love with someone and you want to marry them. You know, and so on and so forth. You know, you think about these realities, it's the deeper part that really it just drives. And that's what it's talking about right there. It says, set your affection. Set your drive, set your motivation on things above. That's why I can't go a day without acknowledging God.
Amen.
I believe if you're truly born again, you cannot go a day without acknowledging your Father. In whatever capacity, whether it's in a place of repentance, like I find myself many times, where I'm like, God, I know I didn't get with you, because I know what it's like to be with you. And I hate the fact that I can't be with you right now. And I think for some reason, God being God, totally understands what you're saying. You know, as sometimes we're just crying out in our weakness and we're saying, God, I want to be with you. So I think it's a good thing that we look for Jesus to come back.
Amen.
I think it's the most appropriate thing. I always used to say it years ago. I've been watching these YouTube channels for years. I mean, and I used to think, you know, I struggled with it at first, but what it always did was it kept me engaged with the reality. This life is temporal. It is short-lived. Mm-hmm. Regardless of what's going on in this world, my life is but a vapor. It is going to be gone in a moment. And will I say before God, did I make it count? I was watching Locked Up, of course.
Yeah.
I'm watching a show called Locked Up, okay? It's about people who go to prison, right? And I only like watching it because I see where I could have been. As part of my life, I can associate with these guys because I'm like, I totally get what you're saying, man. If God had saved my life, I would totally be where you're at right now. And something with me in the show, I get it. And I'm watching it, and this guy is sitting there, whole life spent in prison. His whole life, man. He has a 19-year-old son. They find out he escapes prison. He has 12 years left. Older guy. This guy was known for being an Aryan Brotherhood. He fought every fought, only lost two fights in the guard, over 70 fights. This guy's a bad man, you know what I'm saying? You look at this guy, he's a bad dude, right? Very humble, but you can tell he led woman to you. And all I could do is think about this guy, and I'm like, I know this dude, you know, head to head, some kind of stuff happened to him as a kid. No love ever shown to him. And all of a sudden, his son, 19 years old, right? He got to escape from prison, got caught 2 days later. He's amazing he got caught. He's like, he has the same prison his son just got put in the same day. And he's like, this is something of divine intervention. He's like, I can't describe it. He's like, oh, I never got caught. We're talking about a veteran guy in the prison system, knows the system, not a just totally amazing guy. And his 19-year-old son ended up getting put away for 41 years for secondary degree murder. 19 years old. His whole life will be gone. At least about 60. I don't know if he's able to hit parole. And the reality is, as I thought about him, he's sitting there in front of the camera and he's just crying. He's like, this guy who fought all his life, spent his whole life in prison to become something in the prison system, you know, so he could survive. And he's like, how do you describe a waste of life? And I just sat there, he's like, and it got me really thinking, I'm like, how do you describe a waste of life? You know, a life that fails to ever be able to engage in something greater than itself. You know, and I believe when God says you're trying to connect it, it's engaging in something higher than we ever could be, you know. His 19-year-old son got put away from the same amount. It's repetitive. He lost his whole life to the system, too. And it really impacted me because they got to see each other, and it brought me to tears, obviously, in this room by myself, oddly enough, watching these two men hug. You know, because it's a father and a son, man. And the love you got for your son or your daughter, it's unparalleled. It speaks to the deepest part of who we are, I believe, is when you love your child or you love another person, your wife or your husband, in that way. You know, and their embrace is really brought me to tears. I thought about God and the way He thinks of every one of us, man, and how He wants and longs to be close to us every day. And I can't wait for when He does come back, because that will be with Him forever.
Amen.
And I look forward to that. And that's something we should always look forward to, because what it does is it keeps us in perspective. We should never be afraid to look at end times or things that are happening in the world, because all it does is say, you're getting ready to go home if you're connected. Can you be excited about going home to where you belong? And that shows exactly where our hearts are. We're connected eternally, we're ready to go home, and we're flowing with God every day. And that's something that's reassuring in my heart, because I always wondered, I was like, well, you know, some of this stuff's pretty crazy, but it also has always kept me in perspective. I need to stay close to God.
Amen.
You know, so if you're risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sit at the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things of this earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is our life,
shall appear,
then shall you also appear with him in glory.
Amen.
It just kind of pushes everything away if you really let it. If you let it set into your hearts today, if you let it to just set in and say, okay, God, whatever I'm going through isn't going to be compared. You said it really well. Last Sunday, you know, I said the things of this world are not ready, are really to be compared to the things that will happen in eternity. You know, the glory that should be revealed in us. And I thought this is really appropriate because Brother Charles Spurgeon, Pastor Dave shares it quite a bit, and I really like this one from yesterday. It really spoke, it was right on with what the Lord was already saying to me all week, so I want to share it to you. It says, man is a few days and full of trouble. And that's Job 14, verse 1. And it says, it may be a great service to us, before we fall asleep, to remember this mournful fact. For it may lead us to set loose by earthly things. There is nothing very pleasant in the recollection that we are not above the shafts of adversity, but it may humble us and prevent us boasting, like the psalmist in our morning's portion. My mountain standeth firm, I shall never be moved. It may stay us for taking too deep root in this soil for which we are so soon to be transplanted into the heavenly garden.
Amen.
Let us recollect this frail tenure upon which we hold our temporal mercies. If we would remember that all the trees of the earth are marked for the woodsman's axe, we would not so be ready to build our nests in them.
Yeah.
We should love, but we should love with the love which expects death and which reckons upon separations. And if I could just speak to that for a moment, when I realize that moment, I'm setting, when I love someone, I'm loving them in a sense that one day I'm going to have to let you go. You know, when I think about a life that has devoted me for over 10 years, you know, when someone devotes their life to you for 10 years, there is a natural respect factor that plays in immediately. Because over that 10 years, you've learned to love it. And I've realized, and with even my children, when we're sitting in the van yesterday driving, and Gabe, or it's Friday, and Gabe goes, Dad, what is flesh? We're listening to a rap song, you know, Kill My Flesh, and he's like, so I said, you know, and Gabe, this is a shell. I said, this body holds your soul. I said, one day it's going to die, and it has to go back to the earth, because God gave you it to hold the soul. I said, but who you are is Gabe. I said, that's going to go to God.
Amen.
I said, because that's that he gave you that to show who you are in this world. I said, it's temporary. I said, we're only here for a short time here, and you got to make your time count. No matter what you do, just make your time count. And it really impacts me in that sense because, when you devote your time to people, you devote them in an eternal manner. And that's what I realized when I got these guys in Cleveland. I got to just impart as much as I can, a little bit of time I can, to love you in the best way that I can. And that's to hopefully know that you'll see God in that. And it says, our dear relations are but loan to us. And the hour when we must return them to the lender's hand, maybe even at the door. The like is certainly true of our worldly goods. Do not riches take themselves wings and fly away? Our health is equally precarious. Frail flowers in the field, we must not reckon upon blooming forever. There is a time appointed for weakness and sickness, and when shall we have to glory God? By suffering, and not by earnest activity. There is no single point in which we can hope to escape from the harp arrows of affliction. Out of our few days, there is not one secure from sorrow. Man's life is a cask full of bitter wine, who looks for joy, and it had better seek for honey in an ocean of brine. Beloved reader, set not your affections upon this earth, but seek those things which are above.
Amen.
For here the moth do not devour, nor the thief breaking in and steal. But there are all joys, and they are perpetual and eternal.
Yes.
And the path of trouble is our way home. Lord, make this thought a pillow for many of a weary man today. And it really just spoke to my heart. I'm not of this world. In it, but I'm not of it. And I'm okay with that.
Amen.
And whatever happens while I'm here in my state, my goal and my end will be to be with Jesus
Thank
forever.
You.
So that should comfort our hearts as we think about that we're not here forever, guys. We're here to make our time count. And I thought it was really cool because as we're really starting to engage in this outworking, I believe it's going to produce.
Amen.
I have faith that it'll produce because what are we really doing? We're bringing Jesus to people. We want to love them the way that God loved us. So that's all I have to say.
Amen. That's good.
Father, thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for the awesome breakfast. Thank you all for our time to just fellowship.
Thank you.
You know, wherever two or more are gathered, there you are in the midst, Lord. So we're here to honor you. No matter what the number, Lord, whether we be many or few, Lord, I want you to know my heart towards you will never change.
Thank you.
And we're here to love you, God.
Yes.
I thank you, Lord, for redeeming us, for giving us a place to sit with you, God, of honor that we never deserve.
Thank you.
We don't deserve it, Lord. But I thank you, Father, you make us into that Son, Lord, every day. So I pray, God, you would just continue to strengthen us, Lord, to not be overcome by the enemy, but overcome evil with good.
Yes.
Lord, to allow these things, Lord, to not grow weary in the well-doing, God.
Yes.
For in due season, we will reap that harvest, Lord. We're not giving up.
Thank
you,
Father.
Fight the good fight.
Thank you, Jesus.
I thank you for strengthening us today, Lord, by your Holy Spirit. And may you be glorified in all that we do, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we pray.
Thank you.
Amen.
Amen. Good, sir.